My name is Brian Haight, and I'm the senior pastor here at Mission Covenant Church. I came here in April of 2004, so we've been here 14 years and change.
Pastor David Venberg, I was part-time at the church. I worked at it full-time. I also taught school.
Bob Hamilton, served on the deacon board, trustee board, pastor relation board, chairman.
I'm Sarah Jordan, and I'm daughter of Francis and the late Lawrence Ekstrom. Well, my family was already part of the MCC family when I was born. I've had the privilege to serve in many different areas of ministry.
We're Mel and Peggy Landon, and we were married in 1955, so we have been married for 63 years.
So I've been a member of the church for 77 years.
We raised 5 children in the church.
The congregation, it was unique and was known as a good congregation. They were known throughout the conference too. They were well thought of by the people of the conference. I think they were very tolerant of me. In fact, they encouraged me.
It was a very pretty white country church is what it was.
I like to think back to my early memories of the church building before the sanctuary was turned around. The front doors were located where the back of the stage area is now. You came in the big black doors into a vestibule. As you came in the front doors to the left, there was a stairwell. And this stairwell went down into the lower classroom area, and also the restrooms were down there. That stairwell is still there today and usable. Adjacent to that stairwell was a staircase which led up to the church balcony. And it was kind of cool to be able to go up into the balcony.
Well, it has Swedish background. It actually came from across the street, Hessel Valley. This was Hessel Valley at that time.
From what I understand, the church's beginnings took place as a result of a split. Originally, the Hessel Valley Lutheran Church, this is where they met. But at a certain point, if I understand correctly, one of the issues was that they wanted to move the church building from here down to where the Hessel Valley Lutheran Church currently is. And there were a group of people that felt like they wanted to stay in this location. And so they got together and decided that they were going to stay here if that church wanted to move there. From what I understand, kind of the origins of this church, this is a multi-generational church. We have people parents are here, or were a part of this church, but whose grandparents, great-grandparents, in some cases even great-great-grandparents, have been a part of this church. And originally, this church was planted by Swedish immigrants, and all the worship services and everything took place in the Swedish language. As kids grew up and spent more time here, they spent more time speaking English than they did Swedish. And so the church had to make a decision. Will we continue to hold services in Swedish, or will we switch to English? And this was a struggle for them. This was a hard decision because this was a part of who they were, their heritage. And yet they knew if they wanted to continue to reach out to the next generation that they had to make a change. And fortunately, and I think the long-term history of the church proves that they made the right decision in that they decided to make that switch. And there are other churches in our area that didn't, and those churches no longer exist because they didn't make those changes that were necessary in order to continue to reach the next generation. That story, I think, just has a lot of lessons for us as a church of the fact that everyone needs Jesus has stayed the same, and that it's our call, our charge as a church to reach out to the people with that good news of who Jesus is and what he's about and what he has for people and what he wants for them. But the method in which we reach it out, the model in which it's shared, has to be ever-changing and ever-evolving.
Swedish people aren't real, they're not real outgoing as far as loving each other and showing, affection. And since we don't have as many Swedish people anymore, the church has become much more affectionate in our greeting.
I'm sure we all have good and or funny memories of the church over the years. I'm just going to touch on three. One, it involves Alice Carlson, Mary Landon, and a giant pair of ladies' underpants. Two, it involves a large wooden box, Reverend Vemberg, and the word boo. And the third one involves an outdoor worship service, Goldie Carlson, her cane, and a snake.
My favorite memories probably are mostly connected to people that I was blessed to know. I say new because they're gone now. One of my favorite memories is of Bill Sweeney. Bill was the chairman of the church when I was called to be the pastor here. He would show up periodically. He was retired at that point, so he had free time during the day, and periodically he would show up with a couple cups of coffee, and we would sit down together and talk about church life and what was happening, and he always had a lot to teach me, and I was just so grateful for his life and the way that he poured into me. Other people that I remember fondly, two different women, Alice Carlson and Ann Carlson. They were sisters-in-law, and Ann and Alice were never afraid to speak up and speak their minds. Just the other day, my wife was sharing about how Ann had started a Bible study for young moms, and it was just so good for her to have that opportunity to hear what Ann had to share. And then just a couple other people. Bob Hagberg was somebody who grew up in this church, and Bob was a builder contractor his whole working career, and was contracted to help put on the addition to this church. As I shared about him at his funeral, unfortunately he's gone now, and as our Bill and as our Ann and as our Alice, and Bob was responsible for a lot of the stuff you can't see, the foundations, the framing, the trusses, but just was so good that for him to have been a part of that, and for his fingerprints to have been a part of this church that was such a big part of his life. Who was another of my favorite memories is Goldie Carlson. And Goldie, as long as I knew her, was confined to home and bedridden, but that never kind of spoiled her spirit. Her ministry was so often about kids, and just about sharing Jesus with kids and being there in the nursery or in Sunday school. And I think those people all have special memories for me, because as I shared, all of them are gone now, and I was blessed to have been with them, all of them, in the last moments that they spend here. And those are holy moments for me. It's a special moment, special memories. And so I'll miss them. I miss them a lot. And looking forward to seeing them again someday.
I think one significant person was Arthur Landon. He was an old-timer. And he was very encouraging to me.
Well, these various different ministers, they've all been very dedicated. They love the church. They've done their best to fit in. And almost all of them have fitted in and done well. Gilbert Swenson, and he was here from about 1930. Edgar Johnson was here for a while. Then Levi Hagberg came in the 36. Fritz Erickson. Yeah, then it was Dave Van Bergen.
Pastor Jerry and Bobby, that they were fantastic. A perfect timing for them to be here. Well, then Pastor Brian, he's been here for quite a little while now, and his messages are just fantastic. And
of course, it was just sat on a stone foundation. It was nothing but a wood floor over the dirt. Two stoves and so forth. And they finally came to the conclusion they had to do something to get the church modernized. They had to have a heating system because it was cold. So what they did, and I remember it was back in the 30s, middle 30s, between a team of horses and a slip scraper, they made an opening in the wall below the church and back, and they excavated the basement. All of a sudden, they were able to wall off and put a coal furnace in, which changed the whole feeling in the church. And for all of a sudden, they were warm. Well, it wasn't all finished, of course. It didn't have a concrete floor all the time and everything, but we still used it for Sunday school.
There was a couple pillars in the back here where Jim Birch and I used to hide behind, kind of fall asleep, I think, a little bit. Ryan would catch us snoozing off.
The sanctuary was reversed. Yeah. Oh, yes, and the pews were replaced.
The building has changed significantly in the time that I've been here. When I came, we were in the midst of just kind of putting the final touches on a plan for the expansion of the building. But since I've been here, we've added, I believe, about 5,000 square feet. And this sanctuary area that we're in now has changed significantly, and as well as new classroom space, new space in the fellowship hall, new kitchen area, new bathrooms, and so just really a lot of great improvements to our meeting space, and just made it a lot more functional and user-friendly.
Things were done in different stages and different work bees, and then we did have Eric and Bob Hagberg here doing a lot of the contract working ahead of us. We would park down there some because it's gravel ground. You didn't have any trouble parking. You could just park. And we expanded it some, and it was a nice parking lot, but we didn't have a driveway to it. We had a beautiful parking lot with no driveway to it. We discussed that and talked about it. Things drag out, and we would drive up over this back bank, and it was a blind spot. It was quite bad. And one Sunday morning, I was coming out of the door, and there was a young child, and I thought, boy, if a car's coming up over there, that could be very bad. So at that time, Bill Sweeney was the chairman, and I discussed it with him, and he said, well, we'll have to try to get something done, Bob. And so we had there was a dinner or something going on, and Billy says, Bob, get the coffee. We're going to sit here and visit with all these fellows and get this solved so we would have a driveway. We did that day. We got it settled, and it was done. And I believe Billy had his dad come in and doze it out and put the driveway in. And it made it a lot safer having the driveway to the parking lot.
In fact, the building is where I never thought I'd see it, to tell you the truth.
They were constantly at work making changes. That was characteristic of the Sugar Grove congregation.
On a week-to-week basis, obviously we have worship on Sunday morning, preceded by Sunday school for all ages. In the evening on Sundays, we have youth group for 7th through 12th graders. Every other Wednesday evening through the fall and the spring, CKC, which is short for Covenant Kids Club. We have our Stitchers that meet. Their full name is our Heavenly Stitchers. But
some baby blankets that have been made, and these will be taken to the Warren County Pregnancy Crisis Center in February. Also, we give some to the Safe Place, the women's shelter. We also have lap robes and prayer shawls. The prayer shawls we give out to people that we know are going through a difficult time, and they have a little message on them just so that the people know that you know, we love them and we're praying for them, and God loves them too. Also, we have some hats that we will be sending out up to the First Covenant Church in Anchorage, Alaska. And we've done this for probably the last 4 years. And a lot of these hats were made by Susie Dennison. And so it's just a neat ministry to just continue sending her work up to bless people.
Each month, on the first Friday of each month, we have our community lunch, in which anybody in the community who would like to is welcome to come and gather in our fellowship hall for a hot meal. Covenant women meet throughout the year, and that is just any woman who's a part of Calls Mission Covenant Church home is welcome to be a part of that. There's the men's breakfast, and they meet on the second Wednesday of every month. A single women's group, they meet periodically throughout the course of the year, and that's for any woman post-high school through, we put a question mark there, and they gather together, go out to eat, and just enjoy fellowshipping together. But as many times I've encountered people in the community that aren't a part of this church, they ask me what I do, and I tell them where I work. A lot of times people will go, well, where is that? And then I'll tell them, and they'll say, oh yeah, I go by that church all the time, or I see that church all the time, and I think that's great, you know, because that's one of the, obviously, I mean, people have a connection and to us because of our building, and we are known by our building. But as we move forward into the future, I know that the church is more than a building. The church is the people, and that's what I know those people are missing out on if they don't have a church home, is being a part of a community of people that are connected by faith in Jesus Christ. And so as we move forward as a church into the future, what I'm hoping is that we'll go beyond the building, and that we will begin or continue to make an impact on the lives of people in this community. Maybe even some who've never considered coming in to a church, any church, but who will come and find out and experience what life with Jesus is like. And so that's my hope for us as a church as we go forward.